Whether we verbalize them or not, God knows what's in our hearts. He sees the thoughts and intents of our heart. We might as well speak our complaints because He already knows we have them. David was describing his situation to God, but it wasn't that God didn't already know his situation. God can hear us without the sound of our voice, but sometimes we need to hear the sound of our voice, crying out in desperation to God. Sometimes the very cause, the force of the cause in which we find ourselves is so great, we desperately cry out. Did the Lord not do that on the cross himself? Recorded in Luke 23, verse 46, says when Jesus had cried with a loud voice, said unto the Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit. The force of the cause produced a desperate cry unto God. And that's okay. The Lord himself did it. This cave was not only David's prayer cave, it was his preparation cave. What did it prepare him for? The throne upon which he would soon sit when Saul, his adversary, died. How did this cave prepare him for the throne of Judah? Turn to 1 Samuel 24. We read about it there. 1 Samuel 24, beginning at verse 4. David is in this cave. If Saul knew it, he would have killed him on the spot. But Saul was still the king. He was still God's anointed. And David knew the scripture which says, thou shalt not lift up thy hand against God's anointed. And so he was too honorable to kill this man whom he could have killed because he was sleeping there in the cave where David and his men were. And the men of David said unto him, behold, the day of which the Lord said unto thee, I will deliver thy enemy into thy hand, and thou mayest do to him as it shall seem good unto thee. Then David arose and cut off the skirt of Saul's robe privately. And it came to pass afterward that David's heart smote him because he had cut off Saul's skirt. He said unto his men, the Lord forbid that I should do this thing unto my master, the Lord's anointed, to stretch forth my hand against him, seeing he is the anointed of the Lord. So David stayed or restrained his servants with these words and suffered them not to rise against Saul. But Saul rose up out of the cave and went on his way. What was God preparing David for? The throne that he would inherit. He was preparing David to live by principle. Once he was the king, he lived by the principles of the Word of God. Before he was the king, he would not lift his hand against the anointed of God because the scripture said, you shall not do that. He was learning to let God be God. To do what was right, live a principled life, and trust God for the timing and for the promises that he had made. This cave experience prepared him to let God govern him so that he might govern others. Look again at 1 Samuel 24, beginning at verse 10. He was being prepared to let God govern him so that might govern others in behalf of God. David is speaking to Saul, who is now on the outside of the cave. David came to the opening of the cave, and he said to Saul, "Behold, this day thine eyes have seen how the Lord hath delivered today into my hand, thee today in my hand in the cave. And so bade me kill thee, but mine eyes spared thee. And I said, I will not put forth my hand against the Lord's anointed, for he is the Lord's anointed. Moreover, my father, see the skirt of thy robe in my hand. For in that I cut it off, I kill thee not. Know thou and see that there is neither evil nor transgression in my hand, and I have not sinned against thee. Yet thou puttest my soul to take it. The Lord judge between me and thee, and the Lord avenge me of thee, but my hand shall not be upon thee." David is going to one day govern the people of God. And he had to learn to govern himself, to restrain himself from doing something which usually appeared to be a good thing to do. Dear friends, man's wisdom, because of our sin natures, will often lead us to do the wrong thing and believing we're doing the right thing. We must be governed by what God has said. And David governed himself based upon the principle of what God had said about how a man deals with his sovereign. And he spared Saul. He refused to be rash. He refused to take things into his own hands and avenge himself. He let the Lord take care of those things because it was the Lord's business. There was something else this cave prepared him to do. It prepared him never to forget that it is God from whom all blessings flow. Look at verse 7 of 1 Samuel 24. So David stayed or restrained his servant from these words and allowed them not to rise up against Saul. Saul knew that David would be king and that nothing would stop him from receiving God's blessing from the throne, for God had said he would give it to him. But it had to be in God's time. I don't know about you, but one of the hardest things I have to do in all my life is to wait on God. You see a good thing, it needs to be done. You want to take things into your own hand. You want to act as though you are God, and so you run ahead of God. You don't wait for God to prepare your heart, to govern you, so that when he accomplishes the thing he desires to do through you, you'll have the character do it without disgracing God Almighty. Joseph, who would rule the throne of Egypt second to Pharaoh himself, had to be shut up in an Egyptian prison before God could trust him. To govern Egypt. You know the story, and I don't have time to repeat it to you. It would be superfluous. You know it well. From the time David had his dream that his brothers would bow down to him, 12 years from the time of that dream, David was now in an Egyptian prison. It looked like that dream would never come to pass. Though the dream was of God. He looked 12 years later farther from it ever being done, humanly But it happened in God's time. He had to be shut in the Egyptian prison and be governed and restrained by God so that he could govern in a just manner, in a God-dependent manner, once he was allowed to be on the throne of Egypt. The psalmist describes this very thing regarding Joseph in Psalm 105, beginning at verse 17. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came and the word of the Lord tested him. He was in iron fetters in that prison and they hurt his feet. God had to put him in that cave, if you will, before he could govern others. Job was placed one day in a cave of inexplicable circumstances. There was loss, there was sickness, there was rejection, there was the criticism of his friends. Because one day, as we are told at the end of Job in chapter 40, God gave him twice as much as he ever had before. He was the richest man on earth before everything was destroyed and taken from him, including his health, including the sympathy of his wife, including the sympathy of his friends. He spent untold numbers of years, perhaps, in this cave, but he said, "No, God slays me. I'm going to be trusting." God brought him out on the other side. Gave him twice as much as he ever had before. He couldn't have handled it if he hadn't been in the cave. God has to work on our characters before he can trust us with his responsibilities. There are pastors here today. It seems that God has forsaken you.
The devil brought it to my mind. I'm so sorry.
man of God, a child of God, a servant of God, could have thought such a thought about my God. Suddenly I was in a cave of life. I didn't tell my wife. I didn't tell my father. I was too ashamed. I didn't want anybody to know I thought these things about God. There were days I didn't want to eat, hardly did eat. There were nights I could not sleep. And I will not describe the ugliness of it, but the pains of hell literally got hold of me. And the more I went to the scriptures, which should have given me in a rational mind the comforts I needed, the devil took those very scriptures and used them as weapons against me. Lasted 3 years. And all I could do in that dark cave was to say, "Dear God, you know I don't believe this about you. Lord, will you hold on to me and help me to hold on to you? Because I can't deliver myself from this cave. If I'm ever to be delivered, you will have to do it." And one day I was reading again, and I don't know what I was reading. Just as suddenly as the darkness of the diabolic gloom captured me, just as suddenly as that, I was delivered. It was like coming out of black midnight into beautiful noonday. My soul was free. I believe God said to Satan, "Leave him alone, he's had enough." And I was delivered in the cave. I had come to Christ when I was 13 years old. Those of us who were saved early in life never knew the power of God to deliver from the bondage of sin. We know from the scriptures that whether we're saved old or young, we're saved by grace through faith in the shed blood of Jesus Christ. You were never in sin long enough to experience the awfulness of the bondage of sin. So how will you ever speak authoritatively? How will you ever know that God is more powerful than Satan? That he can defeat your enemy? How can you know that? Well, I don't know how God will show that to you. But having come through that experience, I've come to believe in life that God allows each of his children to be tested either in their minds or their morals. I was tested in my mind, and the powers of hell got hold of me, and God delivered me. If he hadn't put me in that cave from which he delivered me, from which I could not deliver myself, how would I ever know his power over darkness? And very quickly in closing, the third point I'd like to make from Psalm 42 is this. It was David's posture cave. His posture cave. Follow as I read verses 4 and 5. "I looked on my right hand, and behold, there was no man that would know me. Refuge failed me. No man cared for my soul. I cried unto the Lord. I said, Thou art my refuge and my portion in this land of the living. He learned to stand with God alone. He learned to stand alone with God alone. He said, In this cave, no man stood with me. I only had God. He learned to be confident that as long as God knew his path. Look at verse 3. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, thou knewest my path and the way that I have walked. And they privately had laid a snare for me on that path. God, you knew about where I was walking. You knew about my path the whole time. And as long as you knew my path, that's all right. Others may not have understood me. There was no man I could turn to. By the way, you pastors, you're all alone where you are. You can't go to your congregation. You can't go to any person. And you just have to cry out to God. God, you know the path I'm walking. And you become confident that as long as God knows, it's all right. It's all right. David came to understand that the way out of the cave is to know God. I looked on my right hand, but there was no man. Refuge failed me. There's nobody to help me out of this cave. Only God can do that. He learned to look to no man, but to God alone. One day, in obedience to God, Abraham took his son Isaac, his only son that God had given a promise that all the nations of the world would be blessed through his seed. And God said, I want you to offer your son on the altar. This heavy-hearted, unquestioning father took him down. His son was about 40 years old at the time on this altar, and just as he was ready to plunge the knife into his son, God restrained his heart, and God prepared a ram in the thicket, a substitutionary offering. Just at the last moment, when only God could help him, he did. When Moses stood between Pharaoh's army and the Red Sea, the waters parted. At just the last moment before those armies of Pharaoh came and devoured them. When the oil and the meal were depleted in the household of the widow of Zarephath, and she was gathering sticks to make a little cake and cook her last meal before she and her son would die of hunger, the prophet appeared and restored the meal and the oil for her. The book of the Acts, chapter 12, tells us that the same night it was determined that Peter would die, the same night he was in the prison and he was decreed to die, God delivered him that night from the cave, from the prison. And Paul described himself in 2 Timothy chapter 4. After he was on trial for his character, when charges were brought by a very vehement, Satan-filled adversary called Alexander the Coppersmith. At that trial, Paul said in my first answer, no man stood with me, but all men forsook me. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me. And know, when we get into the caves of life, the first thing we do is to try to find some human answer, some counselor, some friend, some important person, the mayor of the town, somebody that can solve this political problem for us, this land use problem, this financial problem, whatever it may be. We want some human solution to get us out of our caves where we feel trapped. That's not the way it works. That's not why God puts us in those caves. It's so that we might know who our God is, and that our God is able to deliver us. Father, thank you for being so great a God. Thank you for loving us too much to keep us out of the caves of life. How we dread them. How we do almost anything to escape them, to avoid them. And you love us too much not to let us get in them. You put us in them. You test us. You try us. We find out that you're a prayer-answering God. That you can do what man cannot do. That we serve Almighty God, whose hand is not shortened and whose ear is not heavy, that he cannot hear. Thank you for shaping our character to be like Christ by our responses in the caves. Thank you for being willing to use us, Lord, and make us to be content with the process you have to put us through in order to use us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Together now, sing.